Good morning, everyone. My name is Teresa Pardo. I'm the moderator for this session, the second session panel. I'd like to welcome you back to this session on bridging the digital divide between people and countries. The second panel of this session is focused on ensuring that digital dividends improve people's lives. And with that, I'd like to ask the panelists to join me on the stage. Thank you very much. So each of our panelists this morning will approach the question of ensuring that digital dividends improve people's lives from their own perspectives, helping to build new understanding using a variety of ideas, tools, and strategies designed for exactly the purpose of more tightly connecting investments in digital capability with very specific and measurable improvements in people's lives. Drawing a specific link between actions and impact is difficult, particularly as public problems are becoming increasingly complex. In my view, new investments in infrastructure and capability are necessary if new understanding about the link between digital innovation and public value can be created. I'll share as we begin just three of these new investments with you today as a backdrop to the discussion for improving the impact on people's lives. The three that I imagine have to do with the use of data and data analytics to drive policy and program planning improvement. And we've heard some of these ideas already this morning from some of the speakers on the first panel. The first idea is focused on building data-aware culture and sophisticated data management. The second has to do with building capability to use data and the results of data analytics to improve, to answer questions about the impact of those investments. And finally, and less frequently addressed, is building capability to ask good and useful questions. Such questions are the why questions. Unfortunately, we often talk about the how many and how often. But it's more important, or equally important, that we ask why. Why did it work? Why did it not work? And then using the results from that analysis to improve future efforts, using new insights to create new levels of value. With these ideas as part of the introduction to the panel on digital dividends and improving people's lives, let me first review our panel format. Each panelist will have 10 minutes or less, using this morning's model, to present their thoughts on this topic. And then if time allows, at the end of our session, we will have a few minutes for open discussion. So to begin our panel, let me reintroduce Mr. Alejandro Rios Diguez, the Deputy Director General, Digital Government Unit, Ministry of Public Administration, Mexico.
Can you help me? Oh, yeah, thank you very much. I'll give you a brief overview of what we are doing regarding universal internet access in Mexico. This is the very first time that Mexico has a national digital strategy. For us, is the action plan to build a digital Mexico in which technology and innovation will contribute to achieve major development goals. In Mexico, there are 62.4 million people with internet access. This means more than half of the population are connected to the internet. 39.2 households have internet access. The time Mexicans spend online averages about 5 hours a day with a computer, with a mobile, almost 4 hours. These facts led the country to a telecommunications reform. Mexico is one of the few countries that has internet access as a constitutional right. Based on the reform, we created the National Digital Strategy. The National Digital Strategy was designed to harness the potential of information and communication technologies as a catalyst for the country's development. The main purpose of the strategy is to maximize ICT's economic, social, and political impact to improve people's well-being. From 2013 to 2015, the access to the internet service increased by 31%. This means that in 2 years, 15 million more people has internet access in Mexico. This is one of the main results of the telecommunications reforms. We are convinced that connectivity is a greater enabler of rights. Therefore, national digital strategy was designed with several different targets to reduce digital breaches with the help of ICTs. There are more people with web access, which can complete all type of public services procedures online. To make this possible, a presidential decree was emitted to implement the national one-stop shop. The Mexican one-stop shop is the single point of access for all citizens that promotes innovation in government, boosts efficiency, and transforms processes to provide the population with information, services, and spaces for citizens' participation in public policy co-creation. This is why the National One-Stop Shop has become one of the most popular websites in Mexico among Google, Facebook, Yahoo, Microsoft, and Wikipedia. The National One-Stop Shop enables everyone to consult and perform procedures quickly and efficiently without wasting time. Now, we can access to the Mexican government with a computer, mobile phone, or electronic tablet at any time. Today, the National One-Stop Shop is the sixth most visited site in Mexico with more than 500,000 visits per day. In average, the users of the National One-Stop Shop spends 10 minutes per visit. It is important to say that 39% of those visits are taking place from mobile devices. This means that it's a responsive portal. Okay. The National One-Stop Shop has a section for government information that consolidates all previous government websites in one single point. People are now able to find up-to-date information regarding the functions, actions, and programs on which the government agencies are working. Through this section, people have now access to information of 25 ministries and 299 government agencies. The National One-Stop Shop has another section for government services that give quick, easy access to the most demanded federal government services and to all the information needed to carry them out. In this section, people can access to the information of more than 4,000 digital government services, download forms, make appointments, send in applications, and make online payments. There are 786 public services with the digital services standard of the National One-Stop Shop. In Mexico, there are 7.2 million people with some kind of disability, which translates to 6% of the total population. In the National One-Stop Shop, no one is left behind because we are implemented web accessibility features. With the aim to reduce the gender gap and promote the digital inclusion, the federal government created the Digital Prospera program, which consists of two components. Number one, child and maternal health, which works through a mass text message system, which are distributed to RapidPro, a tool developed by UNICEF to provide timely, personalized, and targeted information. These messages aim to help the beneficiaries to take better decisions to broaden their development skills. And number two, financial inclusion and education, which provides financial education, saving programs, and access to microcredits, insurance services, and other financial options. Digital Prospera program aims to innovate and benefit women through the new technologies and mobile tools. It has been calculated that the economic cost of carrying out federal government services represents 4.25% of the country's GDP. Mexico has a goal for 2018 to reduce the economic cost of the government procedures by 25%, but our main goal is everyone to be happy. In Mexico, the petition right is a constitutional right. That's why with the citizens' participation sections of the portal, we innovated to provide a platform that will make it easier to listen to citizens' ideas, report acts of corruption, and participate in building better services and policies in a simpler and interactive system. Until now, we have received more than 27,000 online petitions, facilitating citizens' access to their petition right. On the other hand, we are promoting the publication of open data to create an ecosystem of co-creation of public services to trigger innovation by turning information previously held by the government into a socially valuable asset. With the launch of this portal, 40 institutions have published more than 9,000 databases with data that can be used, reused, and redistributed by anyone. Recently, Mexico launched the Data Tool for Sustainable Development. It's a platform to visualize, explore, and compare indicators related to the Sustainable Development Goals of the Agenda of 2013. These indicators can be consulted through time with different levels of spatial disaggregation, temporal and demographic groups. With the use of open data, more than 60 apps have been developed by the government to the benefit of the Mexican citizens. Among those applications, it's possible to find information and services about security and justice, energy and environment, education, economy, culture, tourism, finance and public contracts, infrastructure, sustainable development, local governments, and more. Literacy is very high among the Mexican people, which amounts to almost 95% of the total population. On June 2015, the federal government launched the project Mexico X, which offers massive open online courses, which has more than 600,000 users. We are creating a whole new way of education in Mexico by incorporating ICT into educational process to improve the quality of education, develop skills in our students, and create a culture of innovation and efficient use of information and technology. In this regard, we have delivered 240,000 laptops to elementary school students, more than 1 million electronic tablets, and 3,000 units of equipment for students with special needs. In 2016, Mexico won the WISIS Prize with the Project Mexico X, among other 20 e-learning applications in the category of quality, inclusive, and equitable education. Connected Mexico is a federal program designed to grant the constitutional right of ICT, broadband, and internet access to the population, creating a telecommunication network that provides free internet access in public spaces. Currently, there are more than 100,000 public places connected with free internet access. There are 32 open connected Mexico connected points in the country, which are community centers for digital training. In these centers, any person can access to the new information technologies to learn how to use them and develop their imagination to create new innovation projects. Well, I have no more time, but I want to take the opportunity to invite you to the Internet Governance Forum to be held on December in Guadalajara, Mexico. I invite you to visit the website igf2016.mx for more information. And finally, on behalf of Mrs. Alejandra Lagunes, National CIO for the National Digital Strategy, and Ms. Yolanda Martinez, head of the Digital Government Unit of the Ministry of Public Administration, I want to thank you for all your attention and time.
Thank you very much. I'd like to invite our second panelist to the podium, Mr. Jacob Puchter, from the senior researcher from Pew Research Center in the United States. He'll be focusing on smartphones and internet usage, making a difference in emerging economies. Jacob.
massive change has taken place over the past decade as internet and mobile technology has spread throughout the world at an incredible rate. The Pew Research Center has been tracking this progression in both the US and around the globe and has found some startling truths based on our recent surveys. First, the internet is not ubiquitous outside of more economically advanced nations. While around 9 in 10 or more of adults surveyed in 2015 say they use the internet in South Korea, Australia, Canada, and the US, fewer than a quarter say the same in huge potential markets, such as India and Pakistan, or in poorer sub-Saharan African nations like Uganda and Ethiopia. There is a stark global technological divide in terms of access. The same division is found in smartphone usage. While many North Americans, Europeans, and wealthier Asian Pacific and Middle Eastern countries report smartphone penetration rates of 50% or more, a great deal of people in sub-Saharan Africa and Southeast Asia do not yet have access to these technologies. But in just the past year, many more people have gained access to smartphones and the internet, and the global digital divide is narrowing. Still, the gap remains, and it is driven in part by the economic gulfs that still separate the emerging and developing world from the rest. For example, our research has found a strong relationship between the per capita income of a country and rates of internet access. In other words, the richer the country, the greater the share of people who say they have access to the internet. Even across emerging and developing nations, more people tend to be online in the relatively richer countries. And this relationship extends to smartphone users too. However, it should be noted that as countries reach a certain level of economic development, which in our research is a GDP per capita of around $25,000 to $30,000 US dollars, the divide flattens out. This means as each emerging and developing country grows richer, technology will reach its saturation point, and this particular divide will disappear as most people worldwide enjoy the benefits of advanced communications technologies. Even with the global technology gap closing, divides will remain entrenched within countries for many years to come. These demographic divides are real and pervasive, even in advanced economies. The most pronounced divides Pew Research Center has detailed are age, education, income, and the ability to read or speak English. The age gap separates millennials, which are 18 to 34-year-olds, and everyone else, those ages 35 and above. And the gaps are enormous. One stark example from our 2015 survey is Vietnam, where 81% of millennials say they use the internet and 56% own a smartphone. Yet, only a quarter of Vietnamese who are 35 or older say they use the internet, and just 17 have an advanced mobile device. Significant age gaps appear in virtually every country in which we survey year in and year out. Another clear divide in internet and smartphone use is by education level. In all 37 countries with subsamples large enough to analyze in 2015, people with more education are more likely to have internet access than those with less education. In the emerging and developing world, the dividing line between people with less than a secondary education and those with a secondary education or more. In this sense, more access to educational resources for children will increase access to the digital technologies of today wherever they live. Another wide gap we see, which is related to education, is income. Once again, in nearly all of the 40 countries surveyed in 2015, those with a higher income, that is, households with an income above the country median, are more likely to use the internet or own a smartphone compared with households falling below the median wage. These differences are especially stark in emerging countries such as Lebanon, Peru, South Africa, Brazil, Malaysia, Russia, and Jordan. One interesting further divide that we found in a 2014 survey of 32 emerging and developing countries is that the ability to read or speak the English language greatly affects internet access rates. For example, in 2014, 90% of people in Lebanon who said they could read or speak English used the internet, compared with only 31% among those who claim no English ability. Similarly, large gaps appear in a diverse array of countries such as Vietnam, Poland, Malaysia, Senegal, Argentina, and beyond. These are not the only demographic divides we find. In some countries, especially in sub-Saharan Africa, gender plays a role in technology access, with men more likely than women to use the internet or own an advanced mobile phone. And the 2014 survey also demonstrated, not surprisingly, that computer owners have a leg up on internet access. It is clear that there is a technological divide in the world, and it is apparent that the gap is closing. But the ultimate outcome of the technological revolution is yet to be determined. Our research finds that despite gains in digital access, there is still skepticism in some quarters about its influence. Our 2014 survey found that while people in emerging and developing economies say the internet is a good influence on education, personal relationships, and the economy, many are skeptical about its role in politics and especially morality. This is a caution against assuming that increased internet access and closing the digital divide will bring consensus as to technology's chosen role in society. Technological innovation is a topic that the Pew Research Center hopes to study more in future years, to explore how the digital revolution will shape our world in terms of public opinion, daily life, politics, religion, and beyond. It is an exciting frontier, and we are looking forward to exploring what a world driven by advanced communications technologies will look like and how it will affect the attitudes and the behaviors of the people who live in it. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Jacob. Our next panelist is Ms. Isabella Grigor-Chekowitz from SAP. She is the Global General Manager for Public Services at SAP, and she'll be presenting on new business models to bridge the digital divide. Isabella?
Thank you, Teresa. And ladies and gentlemen, we are living in, and Teresa has already related to it earlier, in quite interesting but also very complex times, right? So while we are bridging the digital divide and we are looking at how we can capture the dividends from the digital engagement through new business models, we have more impacts on the entire systems around. When we look at the timeless mission of governments, we see that they are more and more impacted by events that are coming more frequently and in higher amplitudes. We are looking at natural disasters being around, quick market changes based on globalization. We are looking at people engaging in a very different way because they are digital natives. And this digital natives gives me a good segue. We have heard a lot this morning already about industrial internet, the fourth revolution. We are, from our perspective, offering a third term, which probably plays into the same place in the digital revolution. And the digital revolution is where we have more and more information available at the fingertip. And we have heard that already, looking at the mobility. We are capable to capture information in a very short time. And people are connected through social media. They can get in touch immediately, spread news, and react on it. We can mine data. This is a major difference to coming to the point of why. We are able to mine data which wasn't either available earlier or we couldn't get access to it because we didn't have the technology on a broader scale. And we have this technology now with new in-memory capabilities coming up. So we can mine that data and go down to transactions to understand what has happened and why it has happened, also in patterns. We can enhance our use of data with predictive analytics coming from connected sensors and artificial intelligence. And the artificial intelligence has a huge renaissance. Everything is now connected and everything is digital, presenting the view except the human being. So we are the only analog leftovers here. We said we can connect the sensors, we can connect the history, and think about you have sensors in a city that are connected to the infrastructure, they are connected to the weather information, they are connected to the history, and when you predict on that one, you can trigger actions out of that predictions and save people's lives, save homes. This is already a capturing on the dividends from the digital. Look at the side of healthcare, that is a very important one. Where we are heavily engaged is in the cancer research. If you look at thousands of patient databases that provide the basis for the best treatment for a very specific cancer case, taking into consideration the age of the patient, the life circumstances, the treatment that has been successful in that specific group, and the success rate. Isn't that wonderful that we can save people's life or at least give a better predictions and a better basis to serve decisions? And finally, the capability of cloud makes it more accessible to everybody. So, if you take that together, we have all the impacts on the system and we have the technological changes. What is the contribution of government into those changes and the business model? And we see that governments can be a big role model or can trigger the bridging the gap by being a role model and using and being the front rider on using digital technologies. Look at a reimagination of business model. We see the future being more a government made for me. So government delivering the customer-like citizen experience with personalized anticipatory services, proactive and self-managed. And we've seen that already, that this is, for example, a great example from Mexico. Public sector organization needs to invest into the standardization of this business processes and shift that also very much to the outside to make it very consumer driven, because consumers, because citizens are expecting it from the government. When you look at the security side, we are very much looking at surge capacity. Surge capacity is a flexible scale up and down of capabilities, for example, in the security space, to match that easily and to make predictions how to best use the equipment that also releases dividends. And finally, having the government as an enabler rather than a static provider of services, giving the government gives the environment for business growth, community networks, and crowdsource campaign. This is big. When we look at business processes, the predictions are that 90% of all processes now in place, think of all the processes you are in, are going to disappear or change in the next couple of years, 90%. So that is a huge impact, and this is what governments also need to think about. It's going to be about digital by default. This is the first way to access data, but it needs to be also, of course, in a very inclusive basis. And it is a predict and solve. So give the stuff, give people enough data in hand to ask why, to analyze it and take the predictions. And finally, it is about how things are going to be working together. And we would like to offer also the perspective of the social collective. This is where you also can capture dividends by taking the social collective, getting people crowdsourcing into the game to release the focus from the government into the entire community. So technology plays a major role in the change, and IT is no longer just supporting strategies, IT is the strategy. To be able to deliver on those digital outcomes, governments need to have a clear business strategy, needs to be able to respond to lighter engagements with their customers and attract the digital natives for the workforce of the future. And there is a lot of these great things coming together and seen around the globe. We have the transformation of social services in the APJ area, and this is a couple of countries there where we are looking at citizen-centric, market-driven and inclusive systems. And to the point of disability or different abled people, the engagement with differently abled people in Australia, for example, giving them more self-determinations through networks, through sensors, through just accessibility in a very, very cutting-edge mode to capture their capabilities, also for the sake of the society. It's the switch to the lifelong learning, and it's the focus more and more on the healthcare systems. But we don't need to strive only very far. We can also look at Kazakhstan and how the country has positioned itself with the Digital Kazakhstan 2020 agenda, which, by the way, I unexpectedly discussed with a customer from Australia already this week. So this is already seen as very innovative engagements, and there is a lot of collaboration that can happen and fuse this from all sides. So what is the key takeaway from me is governments need to have a front-running strategy in terms of reimagining the business processes, the business models, the processes, and how they work together. They need to work that and discuss and think about it in a very, very close collaboration between academia, governments, and the industry, because things are happening that fast that can only be captured by a new ecosystem, and finally implement those step by step to capture the dividends for their citizens. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Isabella. Our next speaker is Dr. Kathy Mwangi. Kathy is the CEO and principal investigator for mHealth Kenya, and she'll be speaking on innovative mobile services to maximize impact on the poorest and most vulnerable, how phones are reshaping healthcare in Africa. Kathy?
I'm going to be using a few examples from Kenya. Most of those who've heard about Kenya and mobile technology are very familiar with M-Pesa, which is a mobile banking. And it has been very successful because of the mobile penetration in the country. So within health, we've decided to use technology to bridge some of the gaps that exist. And we still are struggling with infrastructure, ICT infrastructure. So, and since the mobile technologies penetrated very successfully, we are able to use technology to bridge those gaps. So just to start on who mHealth Kenya is, we are an organization that develops mobile applications and have been partnering with the Ministry of Health to, you know, just support, improve, and optimize e-health services, and really with our specialization in mobile technology. The use of mHealth today in Kenya, you know, just to give a brief of some of the statistics, we have 85% mobile penetration in Kenya. We have a lot of challenges because we have very few doctors, and so in the urban areas we have about one doctor to 6,600 people. So if you really want a specialized doctor, there are very few, and so we've been able to use mobile technology to just get information to clinical officers and nurses who are out there, sometimes with very little support from medical doctors. We've been able to use mobile technology for data collection, empowering patients, and empowering community health workers. And again, in Kenya, as many other African countries, we have a lot of use of community health workers, again, because of the challenges of you know, medical doctors. This is one of the examples that we are using currently. This system was motivated by the fact that we have a lot of healthcare workers that are exposed because of injuries, needle stick injuries, or exposed to HIV and other communicable diseases while they are at work. So what happens is that there was no data to show how many healthcare workers are actually injuring themselves at work. You do not know what kind of training to provide to them and what is actually causing these injuries. So this system was actually designed by that challenge, the challenge of having access to this information. And there was also a lot of stigma. Healthcare workers injure themselves. They need to go and take up post-exposure prophylaxis, but they do not do that because of stigma. So, and then there was inefficient protocols. There are certain guidelines that were not accessible to the healthcare workers, and therefore we needed to figure out a way to either sensitize the healthcare workers or have this information available to them to encourage the healthcare workers to access the treatment that they need. The objectives was to promote the uptake of post-exposure prophylaxis and improve the adherence. What you find is that a lot of healthcare workers will actually go and get the post-exposure prophylaxis, the ARVs, and there is a 28-day period that they have to take up these drugs, but they drop them, you know, they drop off the care before the 28 days are over. And we wanted to make sure once they take up the drugs, they're able to complete at least the 28 days. But then they also need to remember to go and get tested like they should. So the system is supposed to work as a reminder that it is time for you to go and pick up your drugs or go get tested. But we also wanted to use the system to monitor adherence. Are they still going? Have they dropped out? And then improve the completion of lab monitoring, the testing. And by the end of it's about a six-month period. By the end of the 6 months, we hope that the injured healthcare worker is safe. But the only way they can do that is by follow-up and just making sure that they are adhering. So this is what the system was supposed to do, help improve these processes. But in addition to that, provide data to the government so they know how many healthcare workers are injuring themselves and where are they injuring themselves. Why is a cleaner at the hospital getting needle stick injuries? Is it that they are not properly trained on how to handle the needles? So all this information is available to them. And so there have been challenges, there was a lot of cost of communication. Initially, we partnered with one mobile technology partner who was not very open to having other mobile network providers come into the project. So over time, we have struggled with that, but now we have all the mobile networks are accessible into the system. There's still stigma. A lot of healthcare workers still injure themselves, but they do not want to go and report. They still were afraid to report themselves in the system. But more and more, we've gotten more, more healthcare workers enrolling into the system. And now we have proper data that can allow the Ministry of Health to make decisions as to the exposures, where the exposures are happening, what counties and facilities need training and all that. So it's been quite successful. This is another system. This system is called Text for Life. And just to give an idea of why we came up with this system, in Kenya, we are not a donor-based country. We do not believe in blood donations. We go and donate blood when our family members are sick, and they need blood. So we wanted to encourage more and more people to become blood donors. Bloodlink Foundation had given a current deficit of blood being at 70%, which meant that at any given time, there is always a need for blood. So the system was designed to try and sensitize the population or the public to recruit themselves to be potential donors or to just donate blood, but more so open up a communication with blood donors to encourage them to become repeat donors. And so that's why this system was developed. And the objective was to increase the number of donors, to increase the number of repeat donors so that people can keep coming back. Create a relationship with donors, open communication, how do they avoid being infected and stay as donors, you know, improve behavior. But also being, most of the time what used to happen is people would go and donate blood, but they would not go back for their results. And every donor who donates blood is tested for HIV, hepatitis A and B, and syphilis. But once they donate, they would not go back for their results. So this is also supposed to encourage them to go collect results and pick up and you know, go find out what their blood type is. The system, you know, you can enroll yourself using a mobile phone, or you can get enrolled on the day that you go to donate blood. And there are different kinds of messages, you know, thank you messages, your blood has saved a life if your blood is used. And we found that with all these, and happy birthday messages, we found that the more you communicate with donors, they feel, you know, they have a personal relationship with the Kenya National Blood Transfusion Services, and they keep coming back. So it's been quite successful. And the first time we actually used the system and to send bulk, you know, bulk messaging was during the Westgate crisis. There was a time when there was a bomb, you know, there were terrorists in one of our malls, and we needed blood. So we were able to send messages to a lot of the previous donors and potential donors we had in the system and tell them where to go donate blood. So it's really helped. And finally, obviously, it has been very successful. We have over 130,000 blood donors in the system who are also repeat donors. And the Ministry of Health is very proud of having this system. And just finally, I'm going to rush through this. We have another system called the KEMSA eMobile. It's a a commodity tracking system. It supports the Kenya Medical Supply Authority, an organization that has the mandate to supply health commodities in the country, and they support over 8,000 facilities. Challenges were that the order for commodities was very manual, so it would take a long time to get the orders to the Kenya Medical Supply Authority, being that if you're based in very remote places, it took a long time to get that order there. So today, people can order drugs from their mobile phone. It doesn't matter how remote you are, and the orders are real time. But you're also able to track the commodities and be able to see how far the approval process is. And once they are dispatched from the Kenya Medical Supply Authority, you know when it was dispatched. And then when it gets to the facility, there is an acknowledgement that it has been received. So previously, there were a lot of challenges because everybody blamed the Kenya Medical Supply Authority for not supplying drugs when they're supposed to be. So the system has allowed for accountability. You can tell who's the problem. If the order has been delayed at the county level, you can tell. So everybody can see the process of commodities once they are ordered, and that's a system that we also helped develop. Way Forward for Kenya, we are really trying to incorporate guidelines, policies. We have our e-health strategy, e-health policy, m-health standards and guidelines all being launched next month, and we are really trying to utilize mobile technology to bridge all kinds of gaps. We only gave examples of three projects, but we have over 10 projects that we have done with the Ministry of Health. And just acknowledgement from some of our partners, and thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Kathy. The challenge that all of our panelists are facing is very rich stories in very short periods of time. So thank you very much for everybody for keeping with the time. Our next speaker is Mr. Shahid Uddin Akbar. He is from the Institute of ICT and Development in Bangladesh, and he'll be speaking with us about manufacturing mobile phones to provide access to the poor.
Thanks, Dr. Teresa. In fact, The topic she was mentioning, we have a little bit change in the topic of the subject of the presentation. In fact, I'll talk about shared access point and how it helps to empower the rural communities and through connectivity. And I will share the experience of APTN, the Asia Pacific Telecenter Network. So I serve as an CEO for BID as well as the chairman for APTN. So thank you. Sorry for the interruption. In fact, Justin, for a very brief definition of the telecenters, these telecenter things are not very popular in these days, but what we have seen also that it is regaining the old kind of passion that the requirement and need of these telecenter things have been returning back. So we thought to share the experiences of telecenters. So I tried to give a very brief kind of definition that what exactly the telecenters are. So it's a shared access point, basically where you will find ICT-enabled information and a lot of equipments and other stuff there. And it can be owned and managed by different growth segments, like the entrepreneurs can manage these centers, the government, academic institutes, or NGOs can operate. And there are very basic ICT facilities like the computer, phone, printer, scanner, internet connectivity, digital cameras. These are in a rural setup primarily. And the services offered in a telecenter is mainly covered the livelihood thing, communication, training, financial services like the mobile payments and everything. And then also some entertainment things. We have seen a lot of downloading thing of music and videos, and at the same time the secretariat service they offer. So this is a basic typical structure of a telecenter. You'll find the users and the telecenters. That is the basic interface between the user and telecenter, but at the back end there are a lot of works has to be done. If you want to run an really efficient telecenter, then you have to have a back office, in fact, at the back end. It's not only on connectivity and the equipment. Because you need the service provider, you need the help desk thing, you need experts, you need the services, you need advisors, and also different kind of segments whom you are targeting. So I'll not get into that details. Rather, it's more about the users can visit the rural physical access points and avail different kind of services. So what we have done in Asia Pacific Telecenter Networks, after seeing these all more than 185,000 shared access points available in this network, like within Asia, this part of the world, and they are government-led, private sector-led, NGO-driven, and some are hybrid. Now we call it public-private partnership model, and also the school-based telecenters are becoming very popular in these days. So this was the very long back. It was like in 2000 there was a multi-purpose telecenter established in Bangladesh. So it was in very remote rural areas. And at the same time, what we have seen in 2002 also, the BRAC in Bangladesh, they also introduced an school-based knowledge centers. So these two are very old model of telecenters in a very, very remote rural setup. And the transformation and innovation, if you look into when in 2000, the MPTC model I referred just, it was also covered in the BBC that, okay, it's serving the doctors and the health professionals. This link is still valid, available in the BBC website. So that was long back in 2000. And after all these years, we have seen in Bangladesh particularly, we have now Union Digital Centers, which was rolled out by the government of Bangladesh under the digital Bangladesh program, and the whole objective was to take the services at the doorsteps, and these are basically a setup of within the local government office and managed by an entrepreneur. So this transformation has made during all this long journey. And there are few models when we are talking about Asia Pacific region. You will find NSLA is from Sri Lanka, community common service centers from India. There are Pakistan telecenter network. There are Thailand, they have their own. In Bangladesh, we have Grameenphone's Community Information Center. UDC is around 4,500 centers are enrolled. We have our own one like Batighor Lighthouse Telecenters. There are different branded services available within the country and within the region. So, and they operate like differently. So we tried few things like, okay, how to make the telecenters more useful for the communities. So we thought that, okay, if we can introduce a kiosk touch-based, like an ATM machine, that they can see the information, and then we find that, okay, that might be a good option. But also it was not very, I should say business model-wise, it was not very worthy because it costs a lot for the investment-wise. So it was an introduction in Bangladesh, but then later on we changed the whole model also. So there are a few services, like in Bangladesh we are offering like IntelliZ Steps. They have a program for the digital literacy program, and in Bangladesh we rolled out this thing for the women and the girls students for empowerment and ICT skill. So those services are available in the telecenters. So if I talk about a little bit on the Asia Pacific Telecenter Network, it's a regional network basically based with the 8 member countries, Bangladesh, Thailand, India, Pakistan, Philippines, Sri Lanka, Tonga, Cambodia, and now we host the secretariat in Dhaka. And it was initiated by UNSCEP long back in 2005 and jointly with the Telecenter.org Foundation. And APTN basically fostering the telecenter movements and also promoting broader ICT4D stuffs. And we also want to make sure that this region have this kind of network which can facilitate to empower the communities and building the inclusive information society, which was basically promoted by the World Summit on the Information Society. So the strategic themes of APTN itself is more on the research-based things, that knowledge management and advocacy on telecenter and ICT4D. And we also want to make sure that the gender inequality has been ensured. Like the model in Bangladesh, we tried to, under the Prime Minister's Office, A2I, that one women entrepreneur and also one man entrepreneur. It's a combination kind of thing. And also we have seen to promote entrepreneurship-led telecenters are more sustainable. So we are trying to promote and considering as SME these telecenters. And also the environment and climate change issue has been addressed through this network. And we are now promoting a lot of new innovation like the smart village kind of concepts, and cybercrime and child protection is also an issue which as a strategic theme for APTN. So if we talk about a little bit inclusive access thing in APTN, we understand that equality and equity has a different kind of definition. If you distribute equally, it doesn't help because some people are a little bit behind, so they need additional support. So that is how we do see that equity should have a different dimension to make sure the inclusiveness. And if you look into the evolution process of the mobile, since the mobile phone has become a part of the whole world, especially the smartphone has revolutionized the whole thing. Everything, I just gave an example of the service we promote for agriculture. This kind of interfaces are offering a lot of services which could be offered by the primarily by the telecenters, but now it is also available in the mobile phone. So does it mean that the telecenters is have relevancy in present scenario? But yeah, from the practice we have seen that yes, it can, it is still very much relevant, and it ensures the inclusive access for everybody. And the penetration of smartphone is still very low in the rural areas, particularly the areas we work, that is very low. And the services also offered by the telecenters are unique, like the training programs or the public services. These are very unique, which needs to be on physical access points. And also we have seen that the best option for the public services and business BDS service, telecenters are really, really can play a very vital role. And if you want to promote entrepreneurship, definitely telecenters can play a vital role. So to address these issues particularly, we are aware that yes, since the technology is changing, we have to adjust and accommodate these changes, and we are integrating a lot of these services, how to best fit in, and also the innovation thing we are promoting through the APTN, so within this new ICT ecosystem. And this, I'll just give three references about what are happening in the Asia-Pacific region. Like the Sri Lanka model, the Nenasala is a very famous one. ICTA is promoting this thing. And they have an ownership, public-private partnership models they are working. And we have seen that this kind of model is getting more popularized now. So they offer different kind of education for the kids and students. And they have been doing this thing for last few years. And they have a localized and also a very brief kind of services there, and entrepreneurs basically run these centers. And if you look into the Bangladeshi Union Digital Centers, this data is like an under this, it's a financial figure is very exciting for us, like to sustain the question of sustainability. But if you look into the Digital Bangladesh model, then we already have 4,500 plus telecenter model rolled out, and the PPP has been followed, local entrepreneur in the government, and it was established on the existing facilities. That is one of the principles we follow, that let's not come up with a very new things. Rather, we have resources, so build on that. And also, this Bangladeshi UDC model was more focused on the citizen services and also the gender inclusion, as I shared. And if you look into the yearly service delivery chart, it has grown tremendously during last 5 years. So we do see that the relevance of telecenters are still very valid for this kind of centers. This is one of the examples. I'll just wrap up with this, that the migration kind of information in Bangladesh, the centers are offering a lot of services so that the rural people, they can go outside and get the right information through the digital centers. And also it fits with SDGs. Because of the time constraint, I will not go. The 1, 2, 3, a lot of telecenters are there. And so there are telecenters and also can deliver the SDG, because SDG is more about action oriented. So if there is a telecenter and service points, they can really, really help that. So APTN will foster more on this ICT4D and partnership things and promote inclusive society based on the target set in the SDGs. Thank you very much.
Physical proximity is often the best timekeeper. Thank you very much. Our next speaker is Mr. Hans Timmer. He is the chief economist at the World Bank. He will be speaking up with us on the topic of how far are we from universal internet access, digital dividends for a better world. Thank you, Hans.
Thank you very much, Teresa, and good morning, everybody. It's really a pleasure. I brought many slides from the World Development Report that was published recently on digital dividends. I will try to select a few of those slides to whet your appetite, because it's a report really worth reading. And at the moment we are working on a follow-up report that zooms in to this region, Europe and Central Asia. So this is a typical day on the internet. Many people's lives have completely changed because of the internet. Just think about it, 200 billion emails per day, billions and billions of tweets and sales over the internet. So that's all very impressive, but that was not the question that was answered or addressed in this World Development Report. The question was, how have these changes impacted economic development? How productive is the introduction of internet? And the assumption is that it should have a positive impact on firms, on people, and on governments. Firms should become more productive, people should have access to better jobs, and governments should be able to improve their service delivery. So we have seen already quite a number. We have seen already quite a number of examples where you see this this positive impact illustrated. And in my next couple of slides, I wanted to add some examples.
Could we get someone who could help us with the technical? With the slides.
So there are all these positive examples, but then if we look at the overall impact, what has it meant for productivity in the world? What has it meant for employment opportunities? What has it meant for what has it meant for the quality of services? Then actually you see a very disappointed result. And so the report tried to explain what are the reasons why we don't see a universal overall impact, positive impact of it. But I want to add a couple of positive examples. This is a disabled man in rural China. He used to live on a disability benefit from $200 a month. But now he is trading cattle on Alibaba. Alibaba is a business-to-business platform that already combines 200 million small and medium-sized enterprises. And he is trading now for $50,000 a year, something that was never possible without the digital development. We heard already the story about telephones in Africa. Here's an illustration of how telephones are used for mobile banking. 200 million mobile accounts in Africa. And the purple part that you see highlighted there, that's the part where there are more mobile accounts than normal banking accounts. And then another example of India, 800 million people, they have a digital identity that improves services by the government. And what you're seeing here is young girls that were subject to human trafficking. And because of these digital dividends, they were saved from that. So all these examples are there. But then, as I said, if you look at the overall picture in the world, you don't see that positive impact. And there are a couple of reasons for that. First of all, there are still billions of people without access to internet. So all the examples that we are seeing is for part of the world, but there is still a part that doesn't have access. And then once you have access, it's not clear that everybody has the tools to use that access in a positive way. That is the digital divide that we are talking about. Either people don't have the skills or people don't have the incentives to use it. There might be not enough competition among firms to really increase productivity by using the new tools, or there might be not enough incentives. There might be not enough incentives for governments to improve the quality of the services. And so the conclusion that is reached in the report is that it's not enough just to provide access to broadband, and there is a whole analysis of how you productively provide that access to broadband, but you need all kinds of supporting policies also. If you don't have the right competition policy, then you're probably not getting the fruits from this development. If you are not having the right skills, then you are not getting the positive results. If you don't have the right governance of new market structures, then you have a problem. And so what this graph shows is that you can look at countries in two dimensions. One is how much access to broadband is given, and the other one is what is the advance in the proper supporting policies. So we have two axes, and we see that countries that have better access also have better supporting policies. Kazakhstan is in the middle group, the transitioning group. It means also that just improving IT technology, just increasing the access is not good enough. You have to do the other things also. And I want to conclude with an important observation that not only you need the supporting policies to get any impact of the digital revolution, but you need the right policies also to make sure that the outcomes are really positive. So, if you look at the firms, then it is possible that this technology creates a lot of opportunity for small and medium enterprises, that you have a lot of competition. It is also possible that this leads to more monopolies and more concentrated power in the private sector. And it all depends on the competition policy, which outcome will be there. If you look at people, then it's possible that they all have access to better jobs, and it's part of the human development and the economic development that we would like to see. It is also possible that it increases inequality and that we have that digital divide. And again, it depends a lot on policy, what the outcome is. If you look at the government, then it is possible that this leads to more accountability of the government, more participation of the people in the government, but it's also possible that this provides a tool for more control by the government. And so you have these opposite outcomes that are possible, and therefore it is so incredibly important that we look at the policies in its integrity and that we make the right choices. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much. And our final speaker on this panel is Dr. Anir Chaudhry. He'll be speaking as the policy advisor in Access to Information Program in the Prime Minister's Office from Bangladesh. He'll be speaking on innovative solutions and mobile applications to support the poor and bridge the digital divide. Where are you? There you go, Dr. Chaudhry.
Thank you. I'm painfully aware of the fact that I'm the last speaker before lunch and the crowd is thinning, but I'll try to do my best. So how does this work? Oh, great. Great. Delegates, ladies and gentlemen, the moderator asked me to focus on the why, so I'll try to do that. Maybe I'll skip a few slides. I'll talk about a few stories, not all the ones that I wanted to talk about, but maybe a few. But more importantly, I'll talk about three things. The man behind the machine, the culture of collaboration across the board, and a culture of innovation and a continuous improvement process. When we talk about Bangladesh, often we talk about a glass that's half empty. Poor country, low literacy, electricity is not everywhere. These are the ingredients of ICT, isn't it? And when we talk about service delivery, that's also not a very pretty picture. It's not need responsive, it's very male biased. There is corruption and there is client-patron relationship. Now if the glass is half empty, it must also mean that it's half full. So let's look at the half full picture. So in 2008, when the current government, it was still not the then government at that time, it produced an election manifesto, and in it was clearly written in bold letters, the agenda for digital Bangladesh at the late 2008. And if we compare the worlds in Bangladesh in between 2008 and 2015, we see a dramatic difference. So business as usual has been shut off, and we are leapfrogging. So poverty has decreased, literacy has increased tremendously, and electricity has rapidly progressed across the country to 75% from about 27%. So it is possible to make huge jumps in a short amount of time if you put the combination of the political will and an efficient bureaucratic machinery. Internet has gone up about 88 times in the last 7 to 8 years, from 0.4% to about 35%. And the cost has come down about 140 times. In terms of electronic service delivery, we didn't really have much to talk about in 2008. Now we have over 200 electronic services that are featured every day. And there is significant access, number of access points that have sprung up. Over 5,000, where we didn't have more than a few in 2008. My previous speaker, Mr. Akbar, actually talked about some of these telecenters. In terms of the policy, we actually have ICT embedded in different sectoral policies like health, education, local government, so on and so forth. Let me talk about a couple of examples. 200,000 sugarcane farmers now receive SMS as purchase orders, whereas they used to receive a small piece of paper since the 1930s. And this has actually dramatically changed the way they do business with the government. Again, this is a collaboration between the Prime Minister's Office and the Ministry of Industries. This has also reduced corruption in the sector quite a bit. Millions of women now receive messages over mobile phones. This is a collaboration between the Ministry of Health, the Prime Minister's Office, and a local non-profit organization called DNET. So these messages provide advisory services to pregnant women and also 1 year after childbirth. And this has significantly reduced maternal and child mortality. Students that apply to universities, public universities now, do so with mobile phones. Previously, they used to have to fill out paper forms, make multiple trips. Now, all they do is send an SMS, and the right amount is also subtracted from their mobile phone through mobile banking. What we have seen in the last 3 to 4 years since this was introduced is the number of girls applying to public universities has risen from 25% to 33%. Mr. Agbo talked about telecenters. This has been a remarkable phenomenon in Bangladesh. This received the 2014 WISIS Prize, serves about 6 million underserved customers every month. We have over 5,000 in local government institutions, and another 8,500 are being set up in the next 2 years in post offices. And we have about 25,000 entrepreneurs that actually serve customers from these. And there is gender parity that we're trying to maintain. This whole of government initiative called the National Portal, which brings together 43,000 offices of the government under one umbrella, received the 2015 WISIS Prize. And this is, in one respect, a remarkable example of crowdsourcing. About 70,000 civil servants and 10,000 entrepreneurs, local entrepreneurs of the rural telecenters, worked together to develop this technology over a period of 3 years. We have about 3 million hits on this portal every day. Teacher training has been revolutionized in some sense in Bangladesh. Teachers are training other teachers through this teachers portal. Again, another example of crowdsourcing, where about 120,000 teachers now produce content that are shared across the country. So better equipped teachers are training the less equipped teachers through this portal. This received the WISIS Prize this year. Financial inclusion has been a major area of focus for us from the government. And we are seeing a massive reduction in terms of time, cost, and the number of visits. This is a benchmark that we have introduced within the government, TCV, as we call it. And you're seeing significant reduction in the form of 70 to 80% in terms of time, 60% in terms of cost, and almost 50% in terms of number of visits to government offices. For payments, salary payments, social safety net payments, mobile banking, so on and so forth. We did a quick and dirty study. I have to admit that this was not a very well thought through study, but the result is important. We have seen that the citizens in the last 6 years have saved about $500 million in terms of accessing 23 electronic services. This was a study done on 23 services. We're building a civil registry, very much like the Indian Aadhaar project, by bringing together several of our IDs, national ID, birth registration, health ID, so on and so forth. So this will come up in the next 2 to 3 years, and we're calling it the Civil Registry Plus. We have set up partnerships with global organizations in the private sector, in the academia, and also with governments across the globe. Now I'll talk about, if I may get maybe 3-4 minutes, I have 2 minutes, so I'll zip through the lessons that we have learned. Lesson number one, you need to nudge and nurture. Things don't happen automatically. So we have this massive training program, we call it the empathy training, where we try to unlearn more than we learn, and that has been very, very effective for civil service. One civil servant, a doctor actually, developed a VIP line for the most underserved patients. And this has become the foundation for a health insurance scheme that we're nurturing right now. Lesson number two, policy imperatives. So nudge and nurture is good, but you also need to develop the right policies. And we have something called the annual performance agreement. That's a contract between the cabinet office and all other offices of the government, where simplification of a process before digitalization is an imperative right now. I won't talk about the details, but this has been going on for the last 1 year, and this has shown remarkable results. Lesson number three, our innate competitive nature, human beings are naturally competitive, has been put to good use. We have a dashboard for every district, and nobody wants to be in the bottom 10. So this has been a way to create a sense of healthy competition across the different districts that we have. Collaboration, I talked about both the national portal and the teachers portal. This has been an experiment in massive collaboration. Hundreds of thousands of civil servants, teachers have been collaborating, creating content and teaching each other. Cost has been maybe 5 to 10% of what it would be if we actually outsourced it to the private sector. And ownership of this content is quite high because the creators are using the content. Lesson number 5, we have introduced a sort of a venture capital fund called the Service Innovation Fund for the civil servants and also for the private sector and academia. And in the last 2 years since it was launched, we received about 3,000 proposals, funded about 100 plus. So you see one for agriculture, an agriculture extension officer came up with a way to better diagnose and more accurately diagnose crop diseases. A 3D printer technology has been devised by a local company. And interestingly, they apparently has been exporting to Kazakhstan. So this is a prosthetic limb machine that's being done through 3D printing. Lesson number 6, taking credits is very important. So the innovators within the government, within the private sector need to take credit for what they have done. We have, in the last 3 years, every district has been hosting what is called a digital innovation fair, and there's a lot of credit taking that happens there, which we think can promote innovation. Lesson number 6, recognition and reward. That's another human instinct. We need to be recognized and rewarded for our innovation, for our breakthrough thinking. And we have national level recognition and also district level recognition every year. Lesson number 8, engaging with the citizens through social media, particularly Facebook. So we have about 500,000 people now being engaged through about 800 plus Facebook pages. And this has become the most vibrant citizen grievance redressal system in the country right now. Lesson number 9, partnerships. We talked about that again and again all throughout the last day and a half. Partnership between the political masters and the bureaucratic machinery, partnership across public and private sectors, and partnership across countries. These have ensured that we learn from others' mistakes. And lesson number 10, finally, to be unreasonable. So I won't read out the George Bernard Shaw quote, but the reasonable approach has been to learn from the models of the ICT-rich nations. So our alternative approach is that we don't follow anybody. We identify our own development problems. We learn from both the ICT learning nations, the ones that are so-called developing nations for the most part, and also the developed ICT-rich nations. And we design and co-design with our stakeholders, citizens, development innovations, and we try to promote first and foremost the field-level innovators, because they're the ones who are most willing to take the largest risks. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. And I'd like to ask you all to join me in thanking our panel as they retake their seats in the audience. I think the panel discussion has been very rich, talking about issues of struggling infrastructure, digital payments, regional telecenters, and many, many more ideas have allowed us to come to the point where we can think in a richer way about bridging, improving the value to citizens. And I'd like to now ask you to join me in welcoming to the podium for a closing statement on this session, Mr. Saken Sarsenov, who is the Vice Minister of Information and Communications for the Republic of Kazakhstan, to provide us with closing remarks.
Уважаемые коллеги, уважаемые друзья, уважаемые гости, сегодня прошло очень важное мероприятие преодоление цифрового разрыва между людьми и странами, это очень большая тема. Я хотел бы поблагодарить ООН, ЮНДЕЗУ, непосредственно господина Аквара за помощь в организации данного мероприятия, за совместную работу. Это очень важная тема. Я хотел бы поблагодарить всех участников сегодняшнего мероприятия, все международные организации за очень важную информацию, за очень важные знания, которые мы сегодня получили. Я думаю, что сегодняшняя информация будет использована для дальнейшей работы. По крайней мере, для Казахстана это очень важное мероприятие. Мы думаем, что все знания, которые сегодня были озвучены, мы будем использовать в дальнейшей работе. Хотел бы поблагодарить модераторов, которые сегодня очень грамотно поработали. Коллеги, я думаю, что это наши не последние встречи, потому что Казахстан объявил о госпрограмме «Цифровой Казахстан». Мы нацелены на то, чтобы двигаться вперед активно и агрессивно для того, чтобы решать все имеющиеся сегодня проблемы в вопросах цифрового разрыва, в вопросах цифрового неравенства. Мы приложим к этому максимальные усилия. Хотел бы всех поблагодарить, пожелать всем удачи, успехов. Я думаю, что перед нами стоят большие задачи, новые встречи. Я надеюсь, что все вопросы, которые сегодня были, мы будем поэтапно решать. Спасибо, успехов всем.